Please rise and join in singing an entrance hymn, We Walk by Faith, found on page 15 of the songbook.
Yeah. life in paths that are just and true. Grant that we may be so fashioned by your grace as to become a dwelling pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. You may follow today's reading from the Missal Act. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished.
If for this life only we have hope in Christ, we are the most pitiable people of all. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise. Especially when the words of Jesus our Lord
is given attention to. In today's gospel, Jesus says, "Blessed are they who are poor, hungry, who are weeping, and being despised." So if these kinds of people are blessed, are we blessed? Are we walking the way of blessedness? And those who are rich, who are filled, those who are laughing and being praised instead, cursed are they. So, follow us. And now I'm smiling. So, it becomes so ambiguous if we really pay attention to these words. Where are we heading? In the globalized world of today, this message becomes as real as it is difficult to decipher. According to the reflection of Timothy Ratcliffe, I would like to quote him again, there are three idols in this globalized world, namely, the cultivation of limitless desire, the absolutization of private property, and the deification of money. In short, is desire, private property, and money, three idols. Since time is limited, I will just explain the first two. The third is obvious. But since need and desire is the motor of market economy, that is, where there is need, there is the market that moves economy. The cultivation of need and desire then becomes a guarantee of keeping the economy going. The result of cultivating desires on the part of the producer is consumerism on the part of the consumer. So the one who produces always would like to cultivate your desire or our desire. On our part, who buys, we respond with a sickness called consumerism. And the symptom of consumerism is addiction to shopping. If you are addicted to shopping, then maybe you are already produced, or in you is produced a kind of a desire. Advertisements are always informing us of new desires that we never knew we had. Manufacturing desire so that our consumption is endless. So according to an economist, in market economy, there is a progression from the satisfaction of need to the promotion of desire. Now, I don't know, get it. Before, we need clothing. So, producers produce clothes for us to wear. We need shoes. We have shoes. But now, it is transferred to the promotion of desire. We already have the clothes. They create a kind of more beautiful clothes. So, even though you are already warm, you desire it to buy. We can already communicate with each other very well through, let's say, iPhone 4. They produce iPhone 10 for you to buy. Your desire is enlarged. They don't produce what you need now. They produce your own desire. Before the iPhone 11 comes, you don't have that desire yet. they create the desire in you. So it's like a, so from the progression from the satisfaction of need to the promotion of desire. Now, the market economy is moving to a third stage. That is, it is aiming at the fantasy world of satisfying our every wish. Fantasy world of wish satisfying. I don't know, in Chinese we have that kind of. So in Mandarin Chinese, 叫私人定制. Anyway, I cannot get it. you get it already? If you can get it. Or you can imagine about the virtual world. You wear a kind of glass and you're already in your own world. There is also a kind of movie already projecting the future that you are in control of your own wishes. So the producer is producing a kind of wishing, satisfying gadget or a gadget or anything beyond our imagination. We will be in control of our own wish and we can satisfy our wish according to our own wish. Thus, all healthy market economy detaches desire from the needs of our bodily lives, so that it takes off and becomes remote from who we are. And finally, lets off into the unreality of fantasy. We are moving away from our body into the fantasy of our wishes. That's the producer. They are living something. Consumerism may sing of the satisfaction of physical needs, but ultimately it is anti-body. So for the kids here, I give you an example. The need for food, or even the desire for chocolate, is something real and pleasurable to satisfy. But if it is cultivated bigger and bigger, that our desire for chocolate becomes excessive, then that desire would even endanger our life. You eat too much, you become diabetes or things like that. The desire enlarged or cultivated too far away from our body destroys ourselves. Indeed, as our Lord Jesus said, woe to you who are filled now, for you will still be hungry and in the end destroy your life. So in fact, an intemperate society is destructive not merely of our individual lives, but of human society and the planet as a whole. Because boundless and unquestioned voracity has no respect for the minimal needs of others, but will only devour and devour. So that's our world. Thus, we are urgently invited to look critically at what we are told that we need, and we ask ourselves, do we really want this? Why do we want this? Why do we want this? So we are invited to ask questions. Ask questions about the creative desires or even fantasies. Furthermore, another thinker writes, and I quote, advertisement aims to break the link between goods and their real purpose. The car is no longer for traveling or getting work, but rather for attracting young women, for making your peers jealous. By a crowd, I don't know the function. It is crucial for the system to break the link with reality, for that is the only way that we can be constantly manipulated. Our defense against the system is to keep asking ourselves, what is this really for? End of the quote. What is it really for? Is it for really traveling or working? Thus, Christians are encouraged to continue asking questions, and only by asking questions about what is real, we become doctor and we become the blessed poor. And that would dispose us for the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are poor, for the kingdom of God is yours. The blessed poverty, in fact, not only protects us from being manipulated by consumeristic desires, but also prevents us from absolutizing private property. Naturally, the more desire is cultivated, the more is the sense of private property. When the desire is limitless, the right to private property is absolutized. I don't go too much about it. I just want to quote a description of reality written by Timothy Ruffley. He said that it is unimaginable that the 400 richest Americans can have an annual income of $69 billion in comparison with the $59 billion, which was the combined income of the 161 million inhabitants of Botswana, Nigeria, Senegal, and Uganda. And I continue. It is blasphemous that 8 million people a year die of just being poor, while others are unbelievably rich. This is only imaginable because we have deified the rights of private property. What is your property? What is that for? So if the private property is only for personal consolation, the words of our Lord Jesus is perfectly understandable. Woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Is that our own consolation, or our worth of dignity, our sense of value, our private property? Blessed are the poor, the who share, for theirs is the kingdom of God. So according to our Dominican tradition, poverty means freedom from consumerism desires. You always ask, do I need it? If I need it, I get it. If I don't need it, I leave it for others. That's one aspect. Poverty also means I share what I have. So in our community life, we don't have our own savings. We give all our savings to a home of. I know that's impossible for your family, but in your family it is shared. You cannot give everything you have to others. But what about the extra? One Dominican priest, who is my is a Filipino who lives in the Philippines, is that every 2 months I will check my cabinet. If I have one cloth, or if I have any clothes that is not touched, I give it to others. Because in 2 months I don't use it, I will never use it. I give it to others. But that's for him, but it's impossible for us. The winter comes, they eat. But beware, private property, according to St. Thomas, is in service of the common good. What others are in need, we are obliged to share. For Christians, nothing is our real consolation except God. Because aside from God, everything would become an illusion. All worldly achievements and glories would add nothing to me if I am not connected with God. In the words of Jesus, woe to you when all speak well of you, for their ancestors treated the false prophets in Israel. Everything considered as worldly goods as to the false identity. The authentic self is only found in the love of God. Yet with God, everything is real and solid. Even insult or death would turn out as contributing to the fruit of life. The prophet Jeremiah says in the first reading, blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose hope is the Lord. He is like a tree planted beside the waters that stretches its roots to the stream, the divine stream. It fears not the heat when it comes. Its leaves stay green. In the year of drought, it shows no distress, but still bears fruit. With God, everything bears fruit. And St. Paul continues, now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. Christ, our Lord, is the first fruit. So may God bless us and make us the true Christians, not to be manipulated by fancy and offering desires, but always ready to share.
Please rise for the profession of faith. Let us profess our faith. I believe in one God,
the Father of all, Creator of heaven and earth, who always existed and is still. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made, cross-bearing the cross of creation, he came down.
Hear our prayer.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
shepherds of the church. May they put their hope in the Lord who strengthens those who serve his people with integrity. We pray.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
For the rich, the powerful, and the satisfied, may they learn to use the goods of the earth responsibly and in the spirit of sharing. We pray.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
For government and other institutions, may they have the wisdom, the courage, and the honesty to use their gifts and resources in the service of the country, especially for the poor and the powerless. We pray.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
For victims of human rights violation, the suffering members of dysfunctional or broken families, and those who have been led astray by irresponsible depictions of sexuality, may they find hope, affection, and assistance from the local authorities and their communities. We pray.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
For all of us, may we be committed in using respectful language, telling the truth, and upholding the dignity of human rights. We pray.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
Let us pause for a moment to pray our own intentions. All these prayers, we pray.
Loving Father, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, hear the prayers of your people who hope in your infinite mercy. May these petitions help us to see our blessedness above all material goods, possessions, careers, or honors. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please be seated. Join in singing the offertory hymn. All that we have shall on page 3.
Oh,
May this oblation of ours, we pray, cleanse and renew us, and may it become for those who do your will the source of eternal reward. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim.
Together with Francis, our Pope, and Carmel.
Cardinal John Paul, our apostolic administrator, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may remember to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Oh,
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
thank you.
Please rise. Let us pray. Having fed upon this heavenly delight, we pray, O Lord, that we may always long for that food by which we truly live. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for a few parish announcements. This morning, we will have a second collection in support of the Hong Kong Central Council of Catholic Laity Evangelization and Laity Formation Works. We encourage your generous support. The annual spring lunch will be held today at Cheung Banquet, 12:30 p.m. For those who bought tickets, we will start promptly at 12:30. The Laity Mount Carmel English-speaking community is inviting you to join in the following activities. So first, there will be a talk on the culture of the youth in the digital age on the 10th of March. From 2:30 to 4:30, we encourage youth and the parents of youth to join the talk. Please mark your calendars for May 1. We will have a liturgical seminar workshop. And this is a good chance for anyone who is interested in serving more in the service and supporting the parish. We encourage you to join. We always do need more people to help serve, whether it's the choir or readers, so we encourage you to join us on May 1. There will be an English language community pilgrimage to Cebu in the Philippines, July 16th and 19th. So for more information, please go to the main church, and there will be more information forthcoming. Also, just an early announcement with more details to come, we will have a ukulele learning workshop for young people. That's right, a ukulele learning workshop, so stay tuned for more details. We do ask that at the end of the Mass, please note clapping. We like to keep the chapel in a prayer for mood. Finally, please check your seats and ensure you leave nothing behind. We do encourage you to keep the missalette, take it with you, and we ask your help to return the songbooks to the collection point in the back of the church. Thank you for your attention. Please rise. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May Almighty God always keep every adversity far from you, and in His kindness pour out upon you the gifts of His blessing.
Amen.
May God keep your hearts attentive to His words, that they may be filled with everlasting gladness.
Amen.
And so may you always understand what is good and right, and be found ever hastening along in the path of God's plans, made co-heirs with the citizens of heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit